and our hearts sank when we heard, and we are now at war, that therefore we are now at war with Germany. And I can remember my mother looking aghast and then suddenly bursting into tears, because she burst into tears, we all burst into tears. And she said, oh, the Zeppelins will be coming over. She'd been bombed by the Zeppelins in the First World War, so she thought the Zeppelins would come over in this war.
Well, I had to go and get the accumulator, which had to be charged the previous day. You know, you had two accumulators, one being charged and one on the set. And of course, when anything was going to happen, the one on the set was always dying, so that the speaker got gradually less and less. And no way could we have this happen. So I went to our local Guzzy, who used to charge the batteries and the accumulators, and got my accumulator. Then home again to hear the news. Because in those days, Sunday was the family day. The rest of the week it didn't matter, but on Sunday, the family had to be at the table, and we all sat around listening to the speech.
Because we weren't actually at war till he made that announcement, were we? And that was a Sunday morning, and I was making a meat pie for that.
My mother ran up and downstairs bringing pillows to put them under the dining room table, because she was convinced we were going to be bombed straight away. And there was a chicken in the oven, I do remember that, because my father was having someone called George to lunch. And when George finally came and got this dreadful burnt offering, the chicken was absolutely done to a cinder.
Some people were on holiday at the time. Donald Camlish was at the seaside in Devon.
Just before 11, we were called in from the beach, and my mother was very particular about the bungalow. She'd brush the sand off your feet. I remember we used to wear these awful little rubber shoes. And we all sat round the wireless, and suddenly this voice came on very serious, and I remember the words ringing in my ears. And my father, we all looked at him, and he went a bit white. And my mother, I think tears were rolling down her eyes.
But whilst most people were relaxing, some weren't. At the West London factory where he was employed, George Griss was at work.
It was Sunday, of course, overtime. I don't think there was a lot of patronage attached to that. I think it was a question, it was double time working on Sunday. Let's be honest about it. You knew the announcement was going to be made, and that's why, you know, the factory was shut down so the chamber could make the arrangement, announcement. And we looked at each other and I said, oh, well, let's call it a day. We'd better go home and give what comfort we can to our wives and families if they want it. You know, the day was finished from then on, obviously.
So you lost all your overtime?
Well, that's half of it. I've never recovered.
Whilst Bill Gregory was the operator of a dragline machine which was standing by in Hyde Park's Rotten Row to dig up the earth there that people could use to fill sandbags.
I was there. I was waiting. He come along and said, war's declared, Bill. And I start the machine up. Mind you, I should start about twice a day. During the 3 weeks I was there, make sure she was all right. Anyway, when we started up, but that was it. I opened her up and away she went. She was happy, so was I.
Almost immediately after Neville Chamberlain finished his wireless announcement on that hot, sunny Sunday, the air raid sirens went. Although it was a false alarm, it was the first wartime alert.
We had an alcove under the stairs, where the stairs go up, and we all sort of bunched under there. And very brave I was. I put my body across my mother's to save her in case a bomb fell, you see. What I would have done if one had fallen, but that was the idea.